Welcome to Glendale City Church. I invite you to please stand and join me in our call to worship. This is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. O come down, O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before God, our Maker.
Welcome to the Glendale City Church for this worship service. We're delighted to have you here as we worship God together. We have a number of prayer requests that you'll find in your bulletin, and we will be remembering those in our prayer as well. Let us bow our heads. This morning we come with praise to you, the great creator of all. We come to praise you for your blessings to us in this past week, your goodness to us. We praise you for being near those who are grieving, and we pray that the great comforter will be near to each one of them. Be near to those who are experiencing health problems just now and meet their needs. We pray for Rosanna, for Mary, for Daniel Cheney, for James Aston, for Kevin Thiessen. We pray for our nation in these politically charged times, that you will be with us and bless as we move through these next few weeks. We pray for our denomination in the turbulent times that we face. We pray for our church. Thank you for providing a church where we can come to worship, knowing that everyone is included and there is great diversity within our congregation. We pray that you'll bless the many members of this congregation and the many ministries that are being tackled each week. Thank you for your forgiveness and giving us your grace, your daily guidance, the grace to face each day. We pray that you'll continue to lead us, for we praise and thank you. Be this while life is mine, my canticle divine. May Jesus Christ be praised. Be this the eternal song through all the ages long. May Jesus Christ be praised. We pray and thank you. In his name, amen.
To turn to one another and welcome each other in the spirit of Christ at this time.
Join me in the scripture reading, found in your bulletin, Mark 3:31-35. Then Jesus' mother and brother arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my brother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother."
October 22 is a day that is one of those, is a day for Adventism that lives in infamy. As an Adventist church, many of us are familiar with the story of our forerunners who believed they saw in the scripture an exact date for when Jesus would return to earth. And so they told the world, or at least they told the United States. And many people in the United States got ready for that event. And they came to October 22, 1844, and Jesus didn't return. And so that day lives on for us because we recognized, our forerunners recognized at that point that they needed to go back to the scriptures and study more. And they recognized that though their hearts were broken that Christ had not returned, that there must be a mission yet for his people to carry out. And so I hope for you and me that as we mark this date, now I counted this up a while ago, this we're at 172 years, I believe, since that date, that it is a call back to us to be theologically humble, to remember that we probably haven't figured everything out about God, that we haven't figured everything out about the Scriptures, and that it will also remind us that God still has a mission for us, that He is still calling us to carry out His kingdom, to establish it in this world, and that we'll remember that. I want to let you know about a couple things that are happening today and something next week that I hope you will take advantage of. This afternoon, we're privileged, as we often do, to host the Los Angeles Adventist Forum, and we have a couple speakers who are going to be part of a panel discussion that they will lead here at 3 o'clock. It meets in our chapel, and I hope that you can stay by for that important presentation, and there's more info on that in your bulletin. Immediately following worship today, we have potluck. And so I know the folks who have been working for potluck are anxious to have you enjoy some of their delectable food and find fellowship there. Next weekend, October 28 and 29, we are hosting a couple of different events that I hope you will be able to participate in. Friday night, we're having a supper out in our courtyard with bonfire at 6:30, and then at 7:30, we are screening the film Enough Room at the Table. That is a film that covers a group of Adventists from different perspectives talking together about what can the church do to be a welcoming place for LGBT people. For our denomination, this has been a real struggle, and we don't know what to do. And so there's people that come together from various backgrounds, various theologies on what to do about this and how churches can work toward that solution. It's very interesting, very emotional, very, very much a struggling conversation that takes place in this film. And I hope you'll take advantage to watch it and to also think about, in your own context, what does this mean for your role in providing safe space for all. On Sabbath, we're pleased to welcome Herb Montgomery, who's speaker with Renewed Heart Ministries. We were pleased to have Herb here last fall to present a series of sermons on Christ, who He is, and what His mission is, and what our mission is in light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Herb is a phenomenal exegetical preacher from the Gospels. You will want to hear what he has to say. And he has three presentations that he'll be doing at 9:30. And normally our children's worship happens at the same time as our worship service, which will happen next week, but we will also have childcare at 9:30. If you have children, there will be something for your children during that first hour as well. So the first presentation that Herb will do will be at 9:30. Then he will have our worship sermon, and then he will present in the afternoon at 3 o'clock at our Urban Liturgy worship gathering back in the chapel. He's also offered to have small group dialogue during lunchtime next Sabbath, and Panera Bread, just four blocks west of here, we have a conference room there with a catered lunch. If you'd like to be part of that discussion, you can contact our church office and reserve your space. We have room for the first 20 people who want to be a part of that dialogue. So I hope you'll take advantage of this next week, and it's going to be a wonderful weekend. Invite your friends, let them know there's great stuff happening at Glendale City Church. Today is our last sermon in our church vision series. You heard Pastor Leif a couple weeks ago, and I kicked us off back on October 1st talking about the vision of Glendale City Church. We believe that we are about finding God whenever we come together, that we believe there's something special and unique that happens when anybody comes together in the Spirit of Christ, in the Spirit of our Father. The scripture that Jesus says, whenever two or three are gathered in my name, I am in the midst of them. We take that very much to heart. And so you see in our church logo, you see four individuals coming together to form the cross. We believe the body of Christ is formed as we come together from diverse backgrounds, from all walks of life, all ways of thinking, all ways of believing. We believe that somehow something powerful in Christ happens when we come together, and we are devoted to fostering the experience of God in our midst. And so we talked about what it meant to reveal Christ, and that we reveal a Christ that ministers to the skeptic, that ministers to those who don't fit in to a typical church situation, that a Christ that confounds us, that keeps challenging us, that keeps pushing us, a Christ that is so loving and compassionate is beyond anything we could ever imagine. Christ's love has no end, no bounds. This is the Christ we preach. And we are a church that affirms all. We believe that everyone has the Spirit of God working in their lives. We cannot look at anybody as old, as outside of God. In Christ, everyone is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. I cannot, as a member of this church, look at somebody else and say, you are an outsider, you don't belong. God will have nothing to do with you. I can't say that because we believe every human being has been restored and is being recreated in the image of Christ. And so we honor and affirm anyone who we interact with. We cannot dismiss anybody. Today, our talk is about creating new intersections. Before I moved to Los Angeles, anywhere else I lived, there were no such things as pedestrians. Where I lived, everybody was in a car. You never saw anybody walking on the street. There weren't even sidewalks. If you get into suburban Atlanta, it's hard to find sidewalks. That's where I lived much of my life. Because there is no need for sidewalks when everything is so spread out and everybody has to drive. And when you don't have a good transit system, the only way you're going to get around is if you drive or you can get somebody else to give you a ride. When I moved to Los Angeles, my driving had to change because every intersection I came to, I had to watch for pedestrians because there's people walking everywhere. And now when I go out and walk on the street to just walk, if I would ever take a walk down the street, I would never see anybody. Now I'm passing people left and right, having to step out of people's ways. There is this mix, this move of people here where you cannot help but interact with so many different people in a city that is filled with people moving, walking back and forth. You can't avoid people. There is this intersection that happens. And yet somehow we find a way in our city to still avoid each other, to still find a way to stay in our own lane, to stay within our own route and our own circles and our own same people. And we have our regular rhythm and walk and movement in our lives, and we keep in to ourselves. And for churches, we've done this. We have how many churches in the city? 100 of churches in Glendale alone. Who knows how many thousand, tens of thousands there are in Los Angeles. And yet we all have our own space that we go to and stay and come, and we stay at our church. This is the same place we go every week, and we have our same group of people, and we connect there. And that's what our experience is. We have found a way to keep ourselves separate from most of the people in our lives and stay within our own little world. When Jesus came to earth 2,000 years ago, he came into a world where everyone had found a way to keep themselves separate from each other, to keep themselves apart from one another. That there were clear delineations between who belonged here and who belonged there. Who had an inside pass to the upper echelons and who had to find community on the outside and find people that they could associate with who didn't fit on the inside. Everybody kind of stayed in their lane, stayed in their place. There's this hierarchy, there is this caste system that exists when Jesus comes into the world. So Jesus is doing something that a lot of rabbis do. He's operating as kind of this itinerant preacher, and he's walking around from place to place, traveling from town to town, preaching the good news of the kingdom of God that is coming, going into synagogues, going into the marketplace, speaking in people's homes. In the Gospel of John chapter 4, you have a story of Jesus wanting to travel north. In order to get to where he wanted to go, though, he had to go through Samaria. And Samaria was one of those places that if you were a Samaritan, you lived in Samaria. If you were not a Samaritan, you did not go into Samaria. You would take the long way around Samaria to get to where you were going, but you did not go into Samaria because you were not a Samaritan and you did not want to interact with them or see them in any way, shape, or form. But Jesus decided to go straight through Samaria. And he does this thing where it's the middle of the day and he goes and he sits down at the well in the center of town. That's not when people go to draw up water from the well. That happens in the morning and the evening, not in the middle of the day, but he sits down there. And this woman comes out in the middle of the day, unusually, to draw water. And as she comes to draw water from the well, Jesus turns to her, a Jew, non-Samaritan, speaking to a non-Jew Samaritan. And he says to her, "Will you give me a drink?" The Samaritan woman said to him, "Let me clarify something for you in case you've missed it. You are a Jew. I am a Samaritan. You are a man. I am a woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" Jesus says to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you don't know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know the Messiah is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." And Jesus said, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." There is something that Jesus does with this woman. He sits at a well in need. Jesus was thirsty. Jesus needed a drink. And he was looking for someone to give him a drink. He came looking to be blessed by someone else. He believed that there was something good that could happen for him, and that there would be something that good that he could do for the other, as they interchanged in this moment of sharing in a shared need. "Woman, will you give me some water to drink? If you give me some water to drink, I have some water that you will greatly appreciate, something profound and deep." And Jesus intentionally expects to break through a barrier. He expects that this barrier between men and women interacting together in public, this barrier between two different cultures and races, that together he would honor God's work in her life and she would recognize God's work in his life. That out of this interaction, something profound would take place. And in fact, as you continue to read the story, something profound does indeed take place. because Jesus reveals himself to her as Messiah, and she goes back to her family and friends and says, "We have found the Messiah, he is here," and she brings the town to Jesus to talk with him. She says, "He's revealed everything to me about who he is, and he knows my heart. Come meet him." And Jesus interacts with this town in Samaria, and many become his followers. Samaritans who were not Jews, who should not be interacting with Jews, have a Jewish man who comes and reveals himself as Messiah, and they come together and they serve together and they bless one another, and the town is changed by the person of Jesus Christ that is revealed in their midst as they meet together. There's something else about this woman, though. This woman had been around the block. Most likely, she's not the problem, but as has always been the case throughout time, and hopefully we're slowly getting past it, women are the ones who are judged harder than the men, and the woman is considered to be the immoral person, and the man stays moral. But most likely what's happened is this woman's first husband ditched her. There was not equal, egalitarian marriage in this time. This woman was a man's property, and when the man was tired of her, he kicked her out. So he kicked her out. Then another man chooses to marry her. She comes in, after a while, kicks her out. 5 times she gets married, and the husband disowns her. And now that she was able to find 5 men to marry her, because men don't want to use damaged goods, now she's stuck living with a man who won't even do the honorable thing and marry her to give her some kind of protection and income. Now they're just living together. She's stuck in the cycle of misuse and abuse by a number of men. But Jesus knows that about her and does not see her as outside of God's favor, incapable of having God's Spirit, filled with demons. He looks at this woman, who everybody else has written off, and he says, "You are God's daughter, and God's Spirit is alive and at work in you." And he restores her dignity and worth. How many people did Jesus come out to, at least according to the gospel record, and where he actually said he was the Messiah? Hardly anybody. He gifts this woman, who was rejected by everybody else, with the greatest revelation in Earth's history. "I am the Messiah. You deserve to know I'm the Messiah because you are filled with God's Spirit. And together we will serve one another and honor each other and honor our Father as we come together." Jesus is moving this conversation, this experience that is happening in this world where everyone's divided into different groups, and he's saying, "Listen, there's a time coming when you're not going to be worshiping in your separate location, and we're not going to be worshiping in our separate location, and we're not going to be having debates about who's theologically correct and who's in error. There's going to be a time where we come together, and we together, no matter what our background, no matter where we're from, we're going to come together and worship together in spirit and in truth." Jesus is moving people in this direction of a place that breaks down, of a community that has broken down these divisions and brings people together in the love and the grace and the mercy of God. And so then, at another time, Jesus is meeting with people, sharing the good news about the kingdom of God. He's talking about what it means, what God is doing now that he's here on earth when he was there 2,000 years ago. And it says that his mom and his brothers come to see him, and they say, and they have somebody go in to grab Jesus and say, "Jesus, we need to interrupt you. Your mother, brothers, your family are here to see you." And as we saw in the scripture reading this morning, Jesus, not disowning his mother and brothers and sisters, but taking the opportunity to give a very teachable moment to everyone who is gathered around him. He said, "Who are my mother and my brothers? Who are my sisters? Who are my cousins? Who are my family?" And he looked at those seated around him, people that he had only met once or twice in his life who are gathered around him. and he says, "Here is my mom. Here's my brother. Here's my sister. This is my family. Whoever is doing God's will is my family." This is why Jesus confounds, still to this day, because Jesus refused to ever look at somebody else and say, "You are not part of God's family." Even when he would get on the religious leaders and push them hard and tell them they're messing things up because they were actually instruments in dividing people, he talked to them saying, "You are called by God to bring people together. You are called by God to show compassion and grace and mercy." He's saying, "Get with a game plan. Get with what I'm doing." He said, "You're not out, but you've got to get with what God is wanting to do in this world." Jesus would never look at anybody and say, "You're out. You're cut off. You're dead to me." He would never say that. Whenever he interacted with someone and that other person was open and seeking, he would never turn them away. And you will see that Jesus never turned away from people. There were people who turned away from him, but he never turned away. Jesus' face was always towards the other and honoring them as his brother and sister. I got to tell you something, and it weighs heavy on my heart. And we're all affected by this. None of us get to skate on this. This is what I'm about to say is something we've all got to wrestle with, and I've got to wrestle with it myself. We are part of the problem of polarizing our society from each other. We are actively at work separating ourselves from each other. I can't tell you what this presidential campaign has done to friendships. How many Facebook friends have you cut off during this presidential election? In the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we're on this ongoing debate and problem about women's ordination. How many Adventist brothers and sisters have you cut off because they think differently than you about women's ordination? Something is happening where we are dividing people up into the sheep and the goats. We're dividing people into the saved and the lost. We have taken it upon ourselves to have figured everything else out about everybody else and have condemned them to hell or had them join us in heaven. And we are working against the cause of Christ. When we have genuine and not superficial disagreements with other people, that we have chosen that those disagreements are so cosmically important that we can no longer interact with one another. You and I have to be people who live in the Spirit of Christ and say, we are moving towards a day where no longer will we be in different political parties. No longer will we be in different denominational unions operating with different rules. but we will all worship together in spirit and in truth. Discuss, debate, dialogue, ask questions, wrestle, but never dismiss anybody as not having the Spirit of God at work in their lives. Do not miss what God is doing in someone else's life. I know Trump supporters who are filled with the Spirit of God. I know Hillary supporters who are filled with the Spirit of God. I don't know about Gary Johnson and Jill Stein. What's up with... No, I'm kidding. There are people who support Gary Johnson and Jill Stein who are filled with the Spirit of God. And there are people, and I will say this here, despite the fact that my general conference, Ted Wilson, and I disagree about women's ordination, Ted Wilson is filled with the Spirit of God. Ted Wilson is God's son. I think Ted Wilson is not paying attention on this issue to what the Spirit is wanting to do in his church. But I cannot write Ted Wilson off as being apart from God. God looks at Ted Wilson and his heart bursts with joy at his precious son. We cannot write off anyone because the Spirit of God is at work. So the mission of our church then is to say, our family, our brothers and sisters, our mom, our cousins, whoever is open to being in relationship with us, these are my brothers and sisters in Christ. And not only just to be open when we happen to bump into people and start a new relationship, but that we would actively do the work of starting new relationships. That we would create new intersections that have never happened before. That we would go to a well we've never been to before and sit at that well and see what happens. That something beautiful in Christ could happen as we allow a person to serve us, and as we have the opportunity to serve them. That sometimes we might be Christ ministering something profound that someone needs, and other times we might be the woman at the well giving a practical need, and the person we serve ends up being Christ to us and doing something profound in our life that we've never experienced before. Because see, here's the thing. We don't have the ownership on Christ. Christ isn't just working in us. It's very likely that we would meet with somebody else and Christ shows up to us in them. So not only if we don't engage in intersections with new people, are we maybe denying their experience with Christ coming through us, we may be denying ourselves the chance to meet Jesus Christ in them. And why would we miss and dismiss the opportunity to have an interaction with the Messiah? We need to find ways to meet together. That's why we've been engaged in some of the things we've done over the life of this church. The recent stuff, like 40 of us walking down to the police station and just having that opportunity to meet with the officers and they get to eat our food. I think for me, I got more out of it than what they got out of it. It was a good Christ moment, woman at the well moment. It's the opportunities that we found to meet together as Communitas does its work of bringing volunteers and people together from different denominations, different backgrounds, and working together to walk alongside people who are working their way out of poverty and experiencing the profound change that happens in that new relationship that never existed before. for the profound Christ experiences when children who have no idea how to play orchestral music, by the time they're done in a school year at Cerritos Elementary School, are playing in an orchestra, playing Dvorak, or playing Beethoven, or playing something else, and the Spirit of Christ dwells in the midst of these kids who have learned music and found new community through the work of Sejura Youth Orchestra. What can we do to make more of these intersections? What can we do to make more of these moments where we get to experience Christ and people in our community get to experience Christ? What can we do? Well, how can we get there? This is our call. This is our ongoing call to keep seeking. How can we create new intersections? I want to invite Johnny Ramirez to come up and join me here on stage. If you haven't met Dr. Johnny Ramirez Johnson before, I want you to know who he is now. This distinguished gentleman, who shares with me the great spiritual gift of male pattern baldness,
important point,
but who is a better dresser with me, knows how to do a bow tie. I have no idea to do a bow tie, so I'm recognizing that spiritual gift in you that I don't have. Johnny is professor of anthropology at Fuller Seminary in Pasadena. He's been a professor around this country, even outside of this country, professor at Loma Linda, professor at Atlantic Union College, professor down in Central America. But he has this problem, is he has a professor's mind and heart, but he's also got a pastor's heart. So he's a little bit schizophrenic.
A lot of them.
And so his heart beats for what can happen in the church. And so I wanted Johnny to share a little bit about his pastoral passion and to share a little bit about what he hopes might could happen here at Glendale City Church. I want to officially introduce him to you as our new volunteer pastor for congregational ministry and evangelism. This man wants to work with us free of charge. Like I said, he has issues that he's working through. But while he's still confused and not sure and not making sense out of this, we're going to take advantage of that and let you volunteer in ministry. But I want you to share your heart about ministry and what you're excited about with the possibilities here.
Thank you, Pastor Todd, for inviting me. And you describe it right. It's an schizophrenic problem. But luckily, the Holy Spirit cannot be rigged.
That's right.
So the work of the Spirit is within us and will be through us as the Holy Spirit has been working throughout our community. Thank you for inviting us to come to the well. And that's the invitation for each of us, to walk to the well. And the idea and dream I have in my mind is to identify where is the Spirit leading? Where are these wells within our communities, because we understand we don't live all here. So it may be that the Spirit is leading you and the well you are to go to is not located in the Glendale City Church area. Would that be okay, Pastor?
Absolutely.
Did you hear that? Again, the Spirit of God cannot be rigged.
That's right.
So the Spirit of God works here in Glendale, and wherever you are from, wherever you live every day or most days of the week. The dream, Pastor, is to together help people and empower them to continue the work of the Spirit that has already begun in their lives. Yeah. Am I making sense?
Absolutely.
And the opportunity to do this doesn't have a particular name, doesn't have a particular stamp of a program. Mm-hmm. It is what has been picking in your brain, working out, that wants to come out through your tongue and say, hey, I have this idea. How about if I was to do this, if we were to do that? Please come and share at the well. Let's meet Jesus at the well. Let's meet the Samaritan woman at the well. Let's have those conversations. I am certain the Holy Spirit has people that belong here, yes, that are not yet here. Besides, there are people, Pastor, that may belong elsewhere, but we will be helping them get there.
That's right, absolutely.
We are in the process of coming to the intersection, going to the well. And that's the invitation we have from our pastor coming from the scriptures, and that is what we hope to facilitate and what we are here to help with. And of course, we have some experience and we have some resources, and the North American Division as well as the Pacific Union Conference has even money. So there may be opportunity for things that you have been dreaming of that could be done and you had no idea how to support. There may be money to help you support that idea of the intersection of Jesus bringing you to the well to meet with the Samaritan woman. That's in a nutshell my persuasion of my schizophrenic brain.
That was good. And so what we want to do is we want to actually start dialogue with that, and we want to do that today. This is a great day to do it. We have potluck, and following potluck, we're just going to kind of curtain off the back half of our fellowship hall. And if you're interested, and when we're talking about ministry, you may have a grand dream, or you may have something very simple, that just something simple that you think could be added. We're not talking about size or scope. We're thinking, what's God's Spirit laying on your heart? What is the intersection that God wants you to create in ministry? And it could be a ministry that happens just intersecting people within this church that haven't met each other, that don't realize that coming together might bless each other in some way. Or it might be connecting us with people outside in our community or out in the valley or out at Redlands. Or some of you guys come in from Palm Springs. So what could happen in Palm Springs that expands the work of Jesus Christ in the world? So if you have time and can spend 30, 45 minutes together, Johnny and I are going to be in that back half of the fellowship hall when people are done eating, and we're just going to talk. There's no agenda. We want to hear from you. We want to just see what God is doing in your life, what's on your heart, and see what can happen.
It is not about deciding who is right and who is wrong. It is not about selecting who will be supported and who will not be supported. It is about you sharing your dream and us together supporting the Holy Spirit in you. Nobody's wrong and nobody will come out right. We will come together working for looking for intersections. Thank you for accepting the invitation. And I have tried a couple of times, but it has not come through right. People have not laughed or even smiled. The Holy Spirit cannot be rigged. Thank you.
Thank you, Johnny. And if you haven't, she's not here today, but Johnny has a magnificent woman he is married to, Clara. Make sure you get the chance to welcome both of them in the weeks to come and thank them that they believe this church is home for them and they want to help in ministry. It truly is a blessing to us. Now it's time for our offering collection. And what we do with this money is to do our best to create opportunities for intersection to take place. Do you know that that at least three times a month, there are magnificent concerts performed at this church that bring in people into our church that have never been here before? Our church values that new intersection. Do you know that in our afternoon worship service, Urban Liturgy, there are people coming to that gathering who haven't been here in the morning service, and they're finding community and spiritual experience in a very odd space where we have worship in the afternoon? We prioritize these things in our ministry. Thank you for your commitment to supporting the work of creating new intersections through Glendale City Church. I'll invite our deacons to please stand. Our God, we thank you that you did not wait for us to find out where you were. You did not hold back your spirit from us until we found out where you lived. But you came and sat down at the well in our neighborhood. And you waited until we came out. And you began a relationship with us that has changed us, that has transformed us, where you as God honored us as your creation, as your children, and those filled with your spirit. Thank you for coming to us. To our gifts today, may we follow in your Son's footsteps and go to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Within you, right now, is the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ. Not because you did anything, but because God, in his great compassion and generosity, placed his Spirit within you. May you watch and look and see his generosity in all the people you will interact with in the week to come, and may you have well moments where you get well. Amen.